रावण जन्म The series of lectures concerned with social development as well as emerging issues and their solutions. This is the third lecture in which we are talking about climate change. The first was about the job crisis due to the global financial meltdown, and the second thing was about national security. This is the third thing. These are the various issues, but still they are interconnected. Either they are connected by means of their interrelativity, or they serve as an additive or exasperator for other issues. If already the person is suffering due to lack of proper employment, poverty, malnutrition, etc., if nature also gives its own contributive blow, then certainly he will be more vulnerable. So these things are additives, distributives, then enhancers, or interrelated causative factors. So these are all really connected with the social problem. If you concern about the social welfare, then each and every the so-called apparently looking different types of topics that we are taking in each and every show, they are somehow connected to a common hub known as the problem of the society and development of the society. These things are unavoidable. Likewise, now we have taken the climate change. Climate change is a very common subject. It is used as a casual as well as an idiomatic usage is also there in the society. Whenever we see something different, we usually say that there is a climate change. There is an environmental change, there is a circumstantial difference. We used to say in atmosphere, not only this atmosphere, living atmosphere, learning atmosphere, earning atmosphere, moving atmosphere, wherever we see a difference, we used to put an idiom that there is a climate change. That is first idiomatic. And second thing is casual. For example, yesterday there was a very hectic climate change when compared to the day before yesterday's climate, and we got a lot of sweating. That is, I got personally, I don't know the reflection on other people. So naturally, different. In various grades of impact or gravities of impact, everybody experiences. So, what we are going to discuss is utterly different from the casual terminology of climate as well as the idiomatic or terminological arithmetic status of the term climate, which is used in various occasions, contextual occasions. It deals with a conspicuous change, a drastic change in the average climate of a region or a globe. It must be substantial. It must be conspicuous, and it must pertain to a big region, a veritable region of the society or the globe as a whole. Then that is known as climate change. And this is envisioned and experienced by means of rise in temperature and wind, precipitation and various other consequential activities. And depending upon the impact, the temporal status of this climate change may also differ. There may be a micro change. There may be a mediocre change, there may be a macro change, there may be an omni change, there may be unit change, there may be bilateral change, there may be a composite change. Depending upon the impact, it may take even few decades, few years or few centuries, or lot of changes that have occurred, they caused innumerable millennia to frame a conspicuous change in the society. So the term level as well as the time level, they are also different and they distinct different things. And finally, the causative factors, it may be the substratum, the substance and the inhabitants, we used to call. Substratum is the earth in which we are living. It may be due to the varying statical and dynamical behavior of the earth observed in geostatistics and dynamics. It may be due to the interrelative factors of atmosphere and various other troposphere, ionosphere and various other spheres of the terrestrial engineering network, which used to interrelate with that of the earth and which can cause these things. And it is known as, they are just forcing factors. They are known as external climate forcing factors, or intruders, or coercive elements, or influential factors. So these factors they can do. And as human beings, we are advanced in knowledge. And as advanced in knowledge, we are advanced in science. The advancement is still there in technology. Still, the advancement in technology is seen as problems and difficulties now. So we are going in stages of advancement. Certainly, we would have contributed a lot, and we have contributed. That is anthropocentric, which is a contribution of the various status of levels of human race. So these type of things are there, and they directly attack only with the two things. There are three substances, you know that. One is solid, second is gas, and third is liquid. And there are two levels of temperature. One is cold and the other is hot. And there is a balance equilibrium, just as we have the samana in the body, we are going to also deal with pulse diagnosis. It is the geopulse diagnosis. The climate status of the nation or a globe or a particular region based on the latitude and position, that is also the salubrious pulse diagnosis of the position. And this is to be understood by means of understanding the temperature and its impact on bodies. There are two major bodies. First is the surface body. Surface body is the Earth's crust surface. This is the apparent surface of Earth. And the second body is a salient body, which is in the form of two things. One is the oceanic, and second is the ice tip or the ice cap. So its reflection on the Earth is different from its reflection on the other surfaces. Reflection on Earth's crust is direct impact, and its reflection on ice cap as well as oceanic tides, rising the levels, boosting the levels, creating more oceanic thermal maximity, all of these things are not direct, but indirectly they can cause or infuse more danger or more turmoil. So these type of various tumultuous things are being discussed today. And we have to differentiate the difference between weather and climate. So we used to call weather and climate as something synonymous, and we cannot perceive the difference in common use. Weather is something which deals with the composite structure. According to mechanics, it is denoted as a chaotic, non-linear dynamic system. So that is entirely different. Whenever you saw the climate, that is entirely different for, that is the average weather that is predictable, traceable, tameable, adaptable, measurable. That which is connected with a common union system, that is having a holistic system which is far beyond traceability, graspability and measurability, that unintelligible as well as capricious composite qualitative system which is chaotically non-linear dynamic in nature, that is known as weather. And climate is the average pertaining to a region which is easily trackable. And there are three major things that is there happening in the world. And before entering this, we must understand, one is the regional impact that penetrates to the regions, other regions. What are the other regions? One is accessible region. Second is permeable region. And third is ubiquity. Whenever there is an accessible region, that is the immediate problem to that annexer. And the second thing is, it is not accessible, but it is permeable. It goes to other regions. And ubiquity means whatever that happens, as per the principle of universality, as well as global consciousness, anything that happens conspicuously or even inconspicuously in some other part of the world, that will certainly reflect, either immediate reflection or remote reflection, tangible reflection, subtle reflection, whatever may be the type. Apart from the spatial, temporal and tangibility modifications, the impact of each and every happening at any corner of the place on the other side is totally immutable and indisputable. So there is accessibility, permeability, and also ubiquity in the global concept. So we have to understand the regional impact on the globe, the global impact on the regions, and inter-regional impacts. If you study even your problem that is happening in Africa, even there is an engulfable, endangering island, Bolo Island at Bangladesh, or even at Mauritius and Maldives, certainly it is our neighborhood problem. Or even if you ponder that it's a universal vision, it is your domestic problem. Even if you ponder it more deeply, it is your internal problem. Even if you ponder it with more cosmopolitan vigilance and altruistic mentality, it is your personal problem. So, depending upon the range and depth of your identity with the global resources, we can just make even global things personal, and you can even just push away personal things as global if you are either a renounced person or irresponsible person. So it is something connected. Before understanding which, unless we have this knowledge, then what is the role? See, somebody is doing something else there. Why we have been called and we have been discussing about something which is not going to do something at the dawn of tomorrow. So for that, it is a personal problem, and we are going to make, just as even in washrooms they have left a message that keep the toilet clean and leave it clean also to your forthcoming generations. Not generations, travelers or passengers. The same thing is an indelible as well as assembled message for the cosmos, that we have to leave it as clean or more clean or at least clean to our forthcoming generations, without doing which it is disloyalty to nature
which according to Shastras, as well as to conscience, as well as to the ethics of survival and livelihood in the globe, where we have been getting all of the resources, it is totally against the rules. So it is disloyalty, it is brutalism, it is lesions at all. So we have to learn all of these things. So there are three major factors. One is the glacial factor, second is the oceanal variation factor, and third thing is the cyclic impact factor. The glacial factor is the primitive factor, as well as the primeval factor, as well as the prime factor, and also the primary factor. Glacial things, they amplify, they do not directly do things, but this glacial determination amplifies the climate change immediately. And there is a phenomenon known as glacial retreat. In summer, you know that the glaciers melt and they form water, and the interrelative phenomenon of melting as well as hardening that happens between summer and winter. So whenever the winter comes, it must be refrozen to the status. But according to the Climatic Conservation Society and their vigilant and meticulous observation of the previous century, this glacial retreat has been totally reduced. That is, the ability of the glaciers, which are melting down at the time of summer, to reorganize and refrozen their status in the form of glaciers, repatriation of the status, that has been reduced. The ability has been made disproportionate. So this has been observed. This is a very alarming incident that happens in the world. And third thing, since this ice age, there must be a regular study of the intergalaxial, as well as intergalactical, as well as galactical and galaxial study. One is on the surface, I told, galactical study. Second is galaxial study, that is a composite impact of constellations, meteors, galaxies, super galaxies, now supernova and hypernova particles, various other planetary intermingled contributive composition, whatever it may be. These things are the major things that happen in the world. The first thing is very much understandable, scrutable. The second thing is easily not scrutable. They may require some sort of subtle perception. And this ice age, it clearly says what are the impacts that are happening in the various orbitary variations, as well as Earth's response to orbitary variations, and which has resulted in the understanding of a final consequence, which is nothing but rise and fall of continental ice sheets. Ice means it is not like the cup ice or the bulby ice that we are taking now. It is a continental ice sheet which is as systematic, which is as colossal, which is as nuclear as that of the plate tectonic system of the Earth's crust. So this type of continental hardcore crust ice sheets, the rise and fall has been totally subjected to confusion. The rise and fall due to the climatic change, their construction, integration, disintegration and reconstruction process has been collapsed. And there are a lot of scientific events which cannot be explained unless we organize a separate seminar, like the Hill-Rich event, Hasgard-Esger event, Young Dryers event. These things are scientific events which have been propounded as the consequential impact as well as counter impact of the glacial variations. Next we are coming to oceans. It is very much interesting and we have to learn these things. There are four major oscillations in oceans. And I have already told, even though oceans, they can affect only coastal areas as per the proclamation given by the people, they alarmed the coastal area. Coastal area is instantaneous, immediate alarm. It does not mean that the non-coastal or distant coastal people are safe and secure. It does not mean so. Socially, politically, geologically, economically, they will be affected. Immediately we are going to discuss in the conclusive area. So, the first thing is the El Nino, the northern oscillation area. Second thing is the Pacific decadal oscillation. Third thing is northern Atlantic oscillation. Fourth thing is Arctic oscillation. These four things are the major oscillations of the oceanic systems. And there is an effect of the thermal energy to induce heat or to repatriate heat in the atmosphere, which is known as thermohaline effect. It can be very simply explained. There are two currents in oceans. One is the shallow warm current, and second thing is the deep cold salty current. The sun's thermal energy, the solar thermal energy, reflects in the shallow area, then it is conducted in between the various reservoirs, which are like shells and hives inside the oceanic tides, and they are just reconverted or repatriated to the atmosphere itself by means of the oceanic emission. So ocean repatriates the heat to the atmosphere, also observes these things. This type of cyclic impact is what we call thermohaline effect. It is absorbing heat and also setting the heat back to the atmosphere area. We all consider that water surfaces just they absorb heat, they reduce heat and make us chill. It is not so. It is one side. So in the other side of the bidimensional impact of heat in the oceanic tides, absorption, retention, transmission and repatriation of the four, that is tetracyclic activities of the thermohaline effect. Third thing is the cyclic effect. Like vicious circles of poverty, it is the vicious circles of cyclic effect of climate change. For example, if an area is dry, immediately it does three impacts. One, it shrinks the already available wet area. It dries the semi-wet area. It enhances the dry area. If there is dryness, dryness creates three impacts. Dryness enhances dryness. Dryness reduces or shrinks the wetness. And dryness apparently dries the semi-wet areas, that is the marshy areas. So likewise, if this dryness is the impact of the society due to the climate change, then it will expand the deserts. The desert lands and the eroded lands, useless lands, non-arable lands, they are expanded. And number two, the plains, they are made dry, and water surfaces like natural reservoirs in the form of ponds, lakes, everything, they are shrunk. Like Samsara Sagara, that thing which was very deep and abysmal, that is just up to the knee level now. So this is the impact. And this impact in turn creates reduced rainfall. And reduced rainfall in turn creates these things. So it is a consequential intracyclic or interlocked system of dryness that is happening. These three things are the major reasons. Everybody is talking about carbon dioxide. Nobody can avoid carbon dioxide. There is a natural settlement in the global system itself. It is known as symbiosis. There is known as symbiosis in the world, which we call as the Ritha in Sanskrit, which is the order of life, in which everything is made with checks and balances. The positivity of a person becomes negativity of another person. And mutually they are challenged, checked, contributed, and there is a gathering, there is a collective way of survival in which each and everybody's contribution is interrelative and made fruitful. For example, most of the abysmal species, like pieces, they used to respire a methanic emission which happens in the abysmal core of the oceans, which if comes outside and being respired by either plants or animals or any other advanced species, either human or subhuman, it will result in the total catastrophe. So that thing is naturally balanced by means of an inbuilt systemic absorption, which is not voluntary, which is not technical, and which is not by means of any request or plea. So it is neither legal, nor constitutional, nor technical, nor scientific, nor by means of any transactive, contractive relations. It is something which is by the selectivity of the nature, or order of the divine, or order of the universal consciousness. What we have to make is, we have to either stop the emission. There are three methodologies. One is minimization. Second thing is avoidance. Third thing is conversion. Wherever there is a problem, the problematic issues are giving you potential also. It is both opulential as well as problematic in nature. Whenever we have to govern such bivalent forces, which cannot be equally eroded or just like that evaded in the society, wherein by most of the social operations are based on such forces, which happen to be unfortunately contrast to the social salubrity or the universal long-term benefits, then we have to take by our prudential sagacity such a methodology by which we can adopt either avoidance. How to avoid? To create a substitute for the same thing. One. Number two, if it is not subjected to the process of substitution, then we have to go for any other alternative methodology of survival itself. Either the action can be prevented, action can be minimized, or action can be avoided, or the substance used for the action can be minimized, or they can be avoided, or they can be substituted something. So it can be either action, it can be the fruit, or it can be the tool, either the sadhana, or the kriya, or the phala, whatever it may be. So if you want avoidance, you cannot avoid it, but we can minimize, we can create a substitute, we can convert. According to Shastras, even to science, even to normal permutation vision of logical perception, that which has a positivity will have negativity. Negativity will have positivity. So there is a bivalent composition of all essential factors of the nature. And the problem is either our technology or our ideology or the present methodology, it has not reached now. For example, before few decades, nobody is bothered about carbon dioxide and its emission and its contribution to global warming. Nobody considered. They bothered only about their house and cream. They did not bother about the greenhouse and its effects. So now, the evolution of science and technology, the more the eyes are opened, the more the windows are opened, the breeze of new vision, new dimensional perceptibility has now created a way for understanding these things. So as the rule of natural emergence, we have started thinking about these things. It is known as cognotechnology. We have started thinking, pondering, working and doing research by means of scrutiny, experimentation, exploration, exploitation, learning from history, mystery. Lot of institutions have resulted in the formation of various other design methods to understand these things. Now it is a proper area. Now we have come to a proper area to exclusively dedicate and ponder upon such issues so that we can get into conversion. Even if we can convert these things, whether that is economically viable or not, for example, if you create oxygen, if there is an oxygen, there is an oxygen club, oxygen bar, which is available at Bangalore and few metropolitan cities. But what is the cost? If everybody is depending upon oxygen bars and cylinders, every day they have to earn $100 exclusively for the respiration process. And what is the cost of water now? It is more than milk. It is more than milk, ghee and honey. It is now nearing ghee and honey. So is it the process? So whatever the nature has contributed, if you want to compensate the same thing by technicality or tactics, it will be 1,000 times more than the value, and it will be 1/1,000th of the contributive value of the natural factor. You will get only 1/1,000th of the effect, but you have to pay into 1,000 times of the cost. So we have to live and abide by nature, and unless something becomes serious, I have already told in one lecture on life management that human being, they have 5 major flaws. One thing is inceptive negligence. Whenever something becomes serious, then only sincerity will come, then only their striving nature will be emerged, then only they will be stimulated for research and adaptation. Till getting that particular area, whatever admonishments that we give and whatever very practically we include in their syllabi or in their lectures or in their writings, it will not be listened by people. So carbon dioxide has been measured by people, how much it has contributed. It is the primary factor. For more than millions of years it has been contributed by various people in various levels. That is one thing known as the Royer compilation of carbon dioxide. CO2 effect is known as Royer compilation. Dr. Royer did that analytical study and he made a view that since even the inception of the spatial intrusion in the earth, the global evolution system, primitive inception system, even from the time 600 million years we have been contributing totally this carbon dioxide to society. And now due to industrialization and various other pollution armaments, it has been made very intensified, but still since the inception it has been started. This carbon dioxide is the primary impact, and it deals with Anthropocene and Ecocene thermal maximity, number one, and number two, it deals with Permian event, it deals with the extinction, that is acidic extinction event, and there is one more event known as snowball earth event. So these are all the various events that are happening in the climate change, as well as technically these things have been addressed, and commonly the things we know what it happens. I've already told in one seminar on the global warming that we have contributed 400 billion tons of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, and now recently they have measured also what is the between the primitive society and the civilized society. Civilized society and agriculture society and industrial society. Industrial society and neo-technical society. So the more the society expands, now for recently from 240 ppm cube, now it has become 379 ppm cube, which is a comparative difference between the pre-industrial era and the post, that is industrial and post-industrial era. So this is what we are feeling in the carbon dioxide level. Second thing is plate tectonics. It is a very massive force, and it is not just like moving this table or something else. Plate tectonics, that deals with the shaping of not houses, it is shaping of continents, oceans and mountains. Cheda, Vibhajana, Akhanda, Khanda, Sankalana. So these things are there. What is Akhanda? Disintegration of composite structures, integration of different and distant structures, boosting their levels, degrading their levels. These things are happening in continents and oceans also. New tides, new waves, new roots, new distances are formed. They are also bifurcated, trifurcated, and tributaries are formed in water surfaces. And also it results in the dealing of mountains also, fixing their altitude level, their movements also, tectonic plateaus, plains, valleys, mountains, oceanic systems, and even continental drifts are caused only due to this plate tectonic system. And then, for example, we can say that there are a lot of plate tectonic changes. For example, they say that even the Himalaya has been brought here due to a tectonic change. And the Himalayas, every year 3.2 inches of reduction is now by the geological survey, they are doing that reduction tabulation they are making. Before 3 million years, it was believed that now the available isthmus of Panama, which is now the different various of Atlantic and Pacific Oceans, they are stopped from mixing together by means of this Panama. And this Panama is only nothing but the tectonic plate shifting or collision between the North American and South American plates. So these North and South American plates collide before 3 million years, and that collision has resulted in the formation of this Panama, which has resulted in preventing or stopping the meeting and mixture of the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. So such drastic changes are happening now. Even though if a change could commence now, we are not going to see the impact after a few million years. But now we are here to see the consequence of that which has been commenced before millions of years. So we must understand, not only as an experiencer of something that happened in an antediluvian society, anti-inhabited society or pre-inhabited society, as well as we are going to leave the experience if not properly inhabited. So a lot of things we cannot avoid. There is one theory which is known as evasion theory. There is escapism theory. If there is a mega incident that is going to happen, immediately we cannot stop that. If there is a very big earthquake, we can just reduce to some level, and we cannot say that every disaster of the global thing that can be prevented. We can minimize the loss of lives. We can minimize loss of properties. So we are not going to change the changes which are very natural and inherent to their development mechanics, but we are going to see that we are safe and secure, and we are trying to minimize the loss and try to prevent some human contributions or some human intrusions which has causated or which has added to the causative factors for these drifting and changes. Already they have discussed about volcanoes. Volcanoes, they release a lot of dust particles which are known as absorbers. They believe that these absorbers, they absorb more of solar heat and they are not properly repatriating it, and thereby producing the chill or cool systems in the society. Now recently, scientists, they have understood that whatever the dust particles that are emanated at the time of volcanic eruption, those particles they absorb and return heat also, and after few months or 1 year, they are resettled in the same earth surface. And this type of volcanic eruption and this contribution is found out to be 130 times more than the impact of other global warming and climate change factors. And the third thing is about solar variability. There is one theory known as a fading young sun paradox. In solar physics, there is a theory, it is known as fading young sun paradox. At first, before now, we are seeing this sun, who is very brighter and red hot and excruciating with its radiation all of us. There was a sun before several millions or trillions of years where he was insufficient or unable to provide proper rays to the surface of the earth because of his thermal insufficiency, because of his negligible thermal infusion and fission. He was unable to make this evaporation process and to retain the cloud particles, and also make by the process of condensation to create rain. So we had such a sun before several trillions of years, as per the rule of fading young sun paradox, that the sun was unable to produce sufficient energy. Now the sun is growing brighter. It is accepted that the sun is growing brighter than before. So this solar variation, how we are going to avoid? It is a natural, it is a heliobasic or a heliocentric theory that he is growing brighter. What we can do that? According to Sandhyavandana and Surya Upasana, there are a lot of mitigation. I think those things are philosophical and religious. How it can be brought to a common platform and how it can be induced in the minds of all people. Rationalists, skeptics, scientists, technicians, everybody, they cannot adopt Surya Upasana, Sandhyavandana, Surya Namaskara and Arjya. So common factor is not possible. So there are two ways. One is a preventable. Second thing is not preventable. So science or religion, it gives you the idea of prevention to preventable areas and how to face or how to develop a courage of survival or minimization or risk reduction in unpreventable areas. This is real prudence. This is real wisdom. It is not just considering everything, just as if you think that you can change everything, that is idiotic. If you think that nothing can be changed, that is lunatic. The person is. So we must understand the difference between preventability and unpreventability. So this is the position of the solar area, and I have told about volcanoes. Then coming to the concluding section, I have to say about the human contribution. Number one, land use by means of agriculture, irrigation and other things. Second thing is afforestation, which is happening now. Like people are growing bald heads, they are also interested in making the earth to resemble their shining heads. Number one is land use. Second thing is afforestation. Third thing is the very famous combustion of fossil fuels. Number fourth thing is aerosols. Aerosols are the particles that particulate matter in the atmosphere. They are known as aerosols. For example, now we are competing with the sulfur-based aerosols now, very much. So these type of various things, even industrial pollution. There are two things in industrial pollution. One is automobile industry. Second thing is production or manufacturing or infrastructure engineering industries. Construction engineering is the worst thing. 900 kgs of carbon dioxide is produced from every 1000 kgs of cement. Nine recent survey, and we can make that 9 kgs of carbon dioxide is produced from every 10 kgs of cement. Now cement must be produced, and we have to contribute CO2 to the society, and by that we have to construct. The construction system is also expanding, multi-level constructions, poly-level constructions, infra constructions, ultra level construction, innumerable things are happening. How? Without spoiling the nature, without exploiting nature, you cannot do that. It is unavoidable. So we have to abide by the nature, and we have to work out how practically these things occur also. And coming to also the section of biodiversity, it also affects the species. The major three affected areas are, one is the subhuman species. See, you must understand, you must not think that human being is doing everything. Even there is the meaning in the life of a worm. Even though not directly connected, it is doing something to its limited area. I have already told personal locus, and second thing is the advanced loci in the form of accessibility, ubiquity and permeability, I told. Like that, each and every species is the creation of God. Either it may be a worm, it may be a fly, they have a purpose. Certainly they have a purpose. And if something is eroded, immediately it has an impact. Either they have been created by nature or God for reduction of unwanted thing or induction of a natural cycle of process. Each and everything, there is a research article on this, how snakes are contributing to the world for human being. How rats are contributing, how parrots are contributing. Each and everything, they have some immediate locus with which they react. And that thing is reacting with the secondary one, that thing with the tertiary one, and it reaches ultimately to the human being for his benefit. So this thing is unavoidable. So extinction of lot of human beings, human race, and species race, even we consider as lot of other accidental, disastrous, and climate variations that naturally occurred, that has made lot of other para-human or pre-human species to be extinct, as per the genetic evolution theory. So now, extinction of lot of species, now there is something known as fox fly. The fox fly is totally made extinct now. If the climate is differentiated from adaptable way of acclimatized way of survival, immediately those who are having the courage to live, they migrate. Those who cannot withstand, they die. Totally they are extinguished. They are becoming endangered, or either they are becoming extinct. Third thing is creating lot of opportunistic species. It is very important in symbiosis or in biodiversity. So whenever the nature creates something, the natural thing, either it demolishes its presence or it migrates to a conducive atmosphere, and the once more the dangerous revolution in the society is emergence of opportunity species. Now we are seeing dengue. We are just claiming with pride that we have demolished most of the diseases. Like we say that yes, we have uprooted plague, we have uprooted malaria. So we say we claim a lot of things. We are seeing the same thing come in a different disguise. We are seeing the same thing more decorative in a different brand. We are seeing new diseases. So these opportunistic species that are emerging in the society is nothing but different forms which give you alarm that something has come or something is about to come or something is within you. So this type of alarming is there. Now there are innumerable systems like Worldwide Wildlife Fund, then Wildlife Trust, then BirdLife International. So there are a lot of innumerable societies, research societies, which are doing some research in order to create cultivable or adaptable land structures. It is known as a landscape scale conservation technology, by which now they are trying to do all of these various things. Then there are final questions. Number one, which may come in all of these general common human minds, skeptic minds or normal minds. Number one, something is going to happen after several millions of years. Why to bother about now? Number two is something is happening in some part of the earth. What about India and why we have to bother about that? Number three, already government scientists and top ranked people, intellectual and potential people are working on that. Why we must be also included in this torture of either lectures or writing or mutual debates? Number three. Number four, what we can do? Yes, I am willing to do what we can do. Number five, yes, I can do something. I have already known I can get from sources. How much we can create impact in the society? How much we can bring some sort of a revital or revitalize this climate change issue to bring back the glory of the serenity and salubrity of the land again? How much we can contribute these things? And now, the final thing is, nature is born for depletion, disaster, deduction, decrease, disease, death. These things, all these are determined and destined. And how we can stop the nature? That is the sixth question. Seventh thing, we have been developing in the society. Most of the developments, even though you can say that it has resulted in climate change, we did not only receive the climate change, but also currency exchange. So how to stop these developments in the pretext of the development of the natural salubrity? So these things are the common questions that is in the society. And these questions have to be very exhaustively, elaboratedly, elucidated in various sessions. Still, whatever I want to say is, we have to make such a system which has more dependence on nature, which has more contribution towards the universal welfare or long-term welfare, and we have to either tune or reduce or abolish the systems that are upcoming. So alternative fuels are being invented, number one. Enhancers, power enhancers, like mediators between the tool and the user, they are used. Additives, they are also used for hyper efficiency. Number four, ultra developed technical mechanism is included, in which with less fuel and less emission, high efficiency rate in performance is being invented. Science should ponder more upon that. Coming to the conclusion, the real conclusion, philosophically, that which contributes to not only the inner but the outer climate change is negativity. We think that the society is spoiled only by the carbon dioxide. It is not so. There are innumerable greenhouse gases that are emitted by human beings in the form of disformity, informity, abnormity, disparity, cleavageal mentality, hostility, hatredness, envy, irreligiosity, immorality and various other things. That is the rule of the philosophy. And if somebody can understand the subtle mechanism of the climate change, they can understand not only the presence of carbon dioxide. For example, somebody told in the recent research that methane and also nitrous oxide is produced by human induction. 65% of the nitrous oxide as well as 37% of methane is produced, which is respectively 293 times as well as 23 times more than the impact of the global warming potential of carbon dioxide. 296 times more than the global warming potential of carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide is there. 37% of methane is induced into the atmosphere by human induction, which is 23 times harmful than the global warming potential of these things. So like there are alternatives for CO2 in the gaseous community, there are also alternatives and equivalence and hypervalence in polluting the society internally, collectively, socially or globally, which are all subtle factors, and they emerge from your mind. And philosophy says the more negativity that you develop, you are spoiling yourself. That negativity also impresses the society as well as the natural factors. The bounty of the nature must be replaced by your bounty in three things: gratitude towards the nature, proper use of the nature and proper distribution of the resources amidst the natural inhabitants. So there is no understanding, number one. We we have only limited understanding, our interim understanding, our immediate understanding, our peripheral understanding of the nature. Then only we realize that, oh, we have done a mistake. And we are in a position, whenever we realize we have traveled a long way, so that we cannot go back. So, understanding the nature, exploring the nature without exploitation, and distribution of natural resources, this is the gratitude which we have to show towards nature. If you are not bounteous towards the nature's bounty will become a blow. Her care will become a curse. Her temper of embracing us will become a torrential tornado which will totally dismantle and disembellish the natural glory. So, philosophy, ethics, or morality, it says that you replace everything by love, proper distribution. So, this is the message of ethicism and philosophy, which we have to just conduct a different seminar on understanding the subtle pollutants of the society in the macro and micro level, starting from your mind, from a mass, that we have to do. And really, we are very happy. And this INVAG has been started just to create a process of dialogue, then interrelative meetings and discussions, and gradually penetrating into the society by small books. For small children and students, we must have illustrated books published. And I have already told, from next month onwards, the previous meetings and their proceedings will be published and distributed in a very handy, precise as well as in a concise format. We have to do all of these things. I hope that this INVAG should take a march in various areas and various issues, and without just stopping within the stage or within an auditorium, it should reach the mass society, the broader and wider society in all regions, because most of the mass, those who are vulnerable, those who are those who are forming the potential quantitative mass of the society, they are uneducated, they are nescient, they are negligent and subservient to their senses and gratifications. Such people should be educated, and INVAG, I wish, bless, pray, and I also want to support that INVAG should take such a lead to create a drastic, the so-called desired change or development that everybody is anticipating in the society. Narayan, Narayan.